John the Baptist. He's a key person in Scripture.
Amen.
There's really not a lot of talk about him these days.
Yeah.
I've noticed. Mm-hmm. But he's the one that prepared the way for Christ, so it's important to have some familiarity with him. Luke 3, beginning at verse 1. Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip tetrarch of Iturea, of the region of Trachonitis, and Lysidanius the tetrarch of Abilene, Annas and Caiaphas being the high priests, the word of God came to John.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All those dignitaries, the word of God didn't even come to them. Named all these dignitaries. And the word of God came to John. The son of John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be brought low. And the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways shall be made smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Then said he to the multitude that came forth to be baptized of him, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits worthy of repentance, and begin not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children to Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Every tree therefore which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. And the people ask him, saying, what shall we do then? He answered and saith unto them, he that hath two coats, let him impart to him that hath none, and he that hath meat, let him do likewise. Then came also publicans to be baptized, and said unto him, Master, what shall we do? He said unto them, exact no more than that which is appointed you. And the soldiers likewise demanded of him, saying, and what shall we do? And he said unto them, do violence to no man, neither accuse any falsely, and be content with your wages. And as the people were in expectation, and all men mused in their hearts of John, whether he were the Christ or not, John answered. They were musing in their hearts, and John answered. I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, and will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire, and many other things in his exhortation preached he unto the people. And Herod the Tetrarch, being reproved of him by him for Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, and for all the evils which Herod had done, added yet this above all, that he shut up John in prison. You want to live so it's a sin to do harm to you. Now, Luke begins with a rather precise introduction. The 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate was the governor of Judea, Herod was the tetrarch of Galilee, His brother Philip was a tetrarch of Arderia, and Lysanias was a tetrarch of Abilene, and Annas and Caiaphas were the high priests. How's that? Being exact. He pinpointed that there's a, see, God, when he does things, it's at specific times. God doesn't operate randomly or by happenstance or here and there. Now, at this time that he named, this was a time of the fourth kingdom depicted in Daniel's, Nebuchadnezzar's dream of a great image comprised of four different sections of metals that degraded from the top down. That stood for four global kingdoms, and we're now, he names, we're in the history of the fourth kingdom, which is Rome. So that's the reason for citing all of this. And then he cites where they were in a spiritual decline. Annas and Caiaphas, it was supposed to only be one high priest. They had two high priests, Annas and Caiaphas, and they weren't good high priests. And so we got a political government is in force that's very precise and very exact, and religion is deteriorating. He's identifying the type of times that we're in. These four kingdoms that were depicted by Daniel's vision were global empires. They all ruled the world. And it, as I understand it, had never been a kingdom like this before. There had been some extensive kingdoms. Egypt was and China was, but they were provincial. They weren't global empires. But these kingdoms were global empires. God gave an interpretation of this, these to him, to Daniel, that the first global empire was Babylonia, or the Chaldeans, of whom Nebuchadnezzar is ruler. Then that kingdom was displaced by the Medes and the Persians, and they were less glorious than Babylon. Medes and the Persians were replaced by the Grecian Empire. That was the time of Alexander the Great. And that was less glorious than the one before it. And then the Roman kingdom, somewhere about half a century before Christ, or 5 centuries before Christ, that empire was replaced the Grecian Empire, and it was less glorious than the Grecian Empire. But the time of our text is during this time of Rome, Roman rule. Pretty well any hope of the Jewish economy being restored was just those with understanding had any kind of a hope. Everything had pretty much acclimated to this arrangement, these things. And I wanted to say a word about why these global empires existed. Why did God allow these empires to rise like this? It's because he had to instruct humanity on what it was like to have a global. See, his kingdom is overall. So, nobody had an idea about overall kingdom. An overall kingdom. His idea wasn't out there. No one had thought of this. I'd say no one thought of it. No one had accomplished a global reign. So these kingdoms were a form of education to teach people there is such a thing as one kingdom that rules everybody in the world. And just to show you that's more than just an idea, we had four kingdoms that actually did that. They actually ruled the world, and everybody in the world had to pay taxes to that. So when someone today says, there may be a one world government, well, we've had four of them already. And there's one coming. I think it's time, well, the ministry needs to be like purged. There needs to be a major purging in the ministry. We got to have some people telling about the kingdom that's coming.
Yeah, amen.
Instead of trying to scare people about a one-world empire, you know, one world. We need somebody to tell people there is a one-world kingdom coming.
That's right.
What it says, doesn't it?
That's right.
Amen.
Now, some things in this kingdom that's being established with Jesus, there's going to be some things accomplished that never were accomplished before. The accomplishment of these things required a global kingdom. It required someone that was overall to get these things done. Now, I'll name some of these. A satisfactory atonement for sin, uh-huh. All sin,
right.
Had to be made.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Now, that's only in the context of someone who's in charge of everything.
Yeah, right.
The sin of the world would be taken away. Not the sin of Israel, the sin of the world would be taken away. See, we're talking global. Satan would be destroyed, uh-huh. Rendered powerless. Principalities and powers that rule the whole world, uh-huh. Were going to be plundered. The law would be ended as a means to righteousness. See, these are not provincial things that I'm saying here.
Mm-hmm.
These are global things. Anybody in the entire world that comes to Christ gets the advantage of these things that were done. They're global things. Yeah. See, there's never been anything like this before. Now, you've got to see that. There's never been anything like this before.
Mm-hmm.
The way would be cleared for men to be born again. An effective means would be established through which man would be made righteous. Anybody in the world.
Yeah, that's right.
See, we're talking about a global kingdom here. The new and living way to God would be established. It'd be for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what part of the world they were in. A means would be established allowing men to be joined to the Lord. No matter who they were. Where they were from, what their nationality was, what their ethnicity was, made no difference. It was global. See, nothing like this had ever happened before.
Yeah.
Yes.
God's displayed the superiority of his kingdom. I know you brought up this one world government people like to try to harp on and warn about, but it's not that frightening if you think about it, because God's already overthrown four global empires.
Yeah, the only global empire.
Yeah.
God has overthrown every global empire that has ever existed.
That's and at
right.
the same time, his kingdom was never threatened.
That's right.
At least.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's still some they want to rule the world.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
England took a crack at it. They tried to rule the world.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, they did. There's English provinces in Africa, but see, they didn't get the job done. They didn't get it done. They tried.
Mm-hmm.
These other four kingdoms, they did it.
Yeah.
They didn't try and do it. They did it. When Nebuchadnezzar and Darius wrote an edict, you know, it was to the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
All people, everybody, went to everybody. Men would be changed from one state of glory to another. This has never happened. This didn't happen with Noah. This didn't happen with Abraham.
Uh-huh.
Nobody. This had never happened to anybody
in
the whole world. Men would be thoroughly prepared to reign with Christ. That would be it. See, men, when they left here, they'd be thoroughly prepared to reign with Christ. Now, what I'm saying is that those things require a global kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
A global king.
Yeah.
Got to have that if these are going to be done. And all of these will be founded on the accomplishments of one man, Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
All this now is beginning, see, and we're reading where this is going to start. The death, burial, and resurrection of Christ are the three pivotal realities upon which all this is going to be accomplished. The kingdom's not going to be accomplished because of the defeat of the enemy. The kingdom is going to be established because Christ died, was buried, and rose again, which meant he conquered every foe.
That's right.
In those three things, he conquered, everything was conquered by those three acts.
Yes,
glorious, isn't it?
Amen.
So God's schooling the people with these global empires in this kind of activity, with this kind of ramifications. People still tend to think regionally. You know, they still think regionally.
Mm-hmm.
Very few churches that have even existed in the world have thought globally. Now, there were some, like the faith of the Roman brethren was heard of throughout the whole world. See, well, this is like, this is unheard of in our day. We've experienced a little bit of this here ourselves. There are people in several parts of the world that know the people here by name. You know what we do. We're just a comparatively small nucleus. But wherever, in any part of the world, it doesn't make any difference where it is or what the language is. Anybody that hears of this and knows the Lord, they can join right in. We're under one common king. We're all really alike.
Amen.
See? Takes a global kingdom now for something like that to happen. Now, at the same time, this is the time that Jesus is going to enter into the world, enter into his ministry. Let's take a look at the state of Israel at this time. They were in Canaan, but another government is ruling Canaan. See, the state of Israel. This doesn't look like an opportune time. They're ruled by Roman officials, Pilate's over Judea, Herod's over Galilee, Philip's over Iturea, which is a district east of Palestine. So the Roman structure of government is ruling. And in the Roman structure of government, a tetrarch was governing a fourth part of a particular province. It was a highly structured form of government. And so tetrarch ruled one-fourth of a particular region. And Israel was just a part. It wasn't even a whole region. It wasn't even a whole region of itself. So the rule of Israel's enemies was in place, and it was according to what God had told him he's going to do this. Way back before they ever got to Canaan. This was stated in the book of Leviticus, 26 chapter, verses 15 through 17. Now remember, I'm commenting on the state of Israel. It didn't look like this was an opportune time for Israel, for Jesus to come. If ye despise my statutes, and if your soul abhor my judgments, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I will also do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, the burning egg, and shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart. Ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. And they that hate you shall reign over you. This is happening in our text. This has happened. Now, if you can receive this, this has happened to the church. The modern church, Jesus isn't the one that's ruling it. I'm emphatic about this, brethren. The modern church, Jesus isn't ruling it. We should know this by what it's like. It doesn't bear the marks of a divine rule. He rules over it in the sense that he's superior to it. He can do with it whatever he wants. But he's not managing profitably the modern church. See, so it looks like, under these circumstances, nothing really significant can happen. It's what it looks like. This is why a lot of people, they drop out of the ministry and they quit, because the time looks like nothing can really happen here. Well, that's exactly what the time looked like when Jesus' ministry is going to start. That's exactly what it looked like then. And in addition to these political disadvantages, the pre-high priests, Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes had hijacked the people.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. They were running the religious apparatus.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
People that Jesus said, they were so bad, Jesus said, leave them alone.
Yeah.
Don't even try and change them.
Yeah.
Don't even try. Leave them alone.
Yeah. Yeah.
Their blind leaders are the blind, and both them and they who they're leading are going to fall in the ditch. Ignore them.
Amen.
He didn't say convert them.
That's right.
Amen. These are the times now. John the Baptist turns up at this in this time. Now you tell me if someone without the Spirit of God can make an impact in times like this. Hey, John's going to make an impact in this kind of time.
Amen.
This proves he's from God. The scriptures say that the people were sitting in darkness when Jesus came. The people sat in darkness. Saw a great light. So the environment was such that only God could make anything profitable happen.
Amen.
And I think that's the time we're in. You can organize, you can go to school, you can have training courses, you can read books. You're not going to make an impact for God because this is the kind of time it can't be done. People have tried it. They're still trying it. They can't change one city. In the entire world, there's not been one city that's been transformed. The early church, right off the stick, a whole city believed, Samaria. Why? What was the difference? God was working in that environment. John's helping to shape a spiritual environment in which Jesus can work. All right, now here it is. The times pretty bad. Israel's being governed by heathen people. The state of their religion is terrible. And the word of God came unto John. Not to Gamaliel. Not to Caiaphas, the high priest. See, the religious structure was set up so everyone expected if God's going to say something, he'll say it to the high priest. No, the word of God came to John. He wasn't a Jewish official. He didn't fit in with the Jewish way. He was a Jew. He was faithful to God, but he didn't fit in the religious structure. There wasn't a place for John the Baptist. But the word of God, that's who the word of God came to. Was John the Baptist. Now, what all came to him, we're not made privy to everything that came to him, but we're given some hints as to some things that were told him. I'll give you some of them here. The word of God came to John. See, he's going to hear some things that's going to be conducive to his ministry, which he's going to prepare the way for Christ in this kind of world at this kind of time. How to identify Christ. He was told how to do that. Yes. He that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom you shall see the Spirit descending and remaining, the same as he that baptizes with the Holy Ghost. As he told him how to. He didn't tell that to anybody else. He did not tell this to anybody else. Mm-hmm. He told this to John. Here's how you'll know who the real Christ is. Mm-hmm. And he told him what to preach. He began to preach, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It didn't look like it. See, it didn't look like the kingdom of heaven was at hand. It looked like the kingdom of Rome was at hand. That's what it looked like. The kingdom of heaven is right here. We're on the border seeing it. He told the Messiah what he would do. His fan would be in his hand. He'd thoroughly purge his floor. He's going to clean the mess up. He's going to come. He's going to clean this mess up. Gather the wheat into his barn. Burn the chaff of the unquenchable fire. He learned that Christ was the consummate bridegroom. John the Baptist said, he that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, that was John, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. See, so he told him that. This was not told even the prophets. The prophets weren't even told this. The prophets weren't told that the Messiah was going to be a husband. John the Baptist was told that. He was told that Christ would increase. He'd come out of nowhere and increase. He must increase, but I must decrease. And it is a truth. As soon as Christ is on the increase, everybody else is on the decrease.
Yeah, amen.
This is how this is how it works. Maybe that's why some people don't want to preach Christ. The Messiah came from above, and he's above all. John has told us, see? He said, he that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthy and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from heaven is above all. See, that was the word of the Lord came to John in the wilderness. And he learned that God gave the Spirit without measure to Christ. John 3:34, John the Baptist said this. And he learned that the Father loves the Son and hath given all things into his hand. John 3:35. And he learned that everlasting life is contingent upon believing on the Son, John 3:36. See, these are some things, who knows what else was told. Now, men have debated for a long time over John 3:31 through 36, whether those are the words of John the Baptist or the words of John the Apostle. There have been hot debates. Well, I don't know how hot they are, but there have been debates about who gave these words. The first of the chapter was clearly Christ talking to Nicodemus. Now, that, verse 1 through 21. Verse 24 sets the stage for saying John was not yet put into prison. Then the reports given of John stating that Jesus was baptizing more disciples than himself. And then the remainder of the chapter, as I understand it, is John talking. This was according to the word of God coming to John in the wilderness. See, this brought all this other on. He had all this insight, not by conclusion. John didn't like read the prophets and then come up to this conclusion. This wasn't how it happened. And believe me when I tell you, this isn't how it happens to you either. You should be a good student of Scripture. Make no mistake about it. You should learn how to think and how to reason. But if you're able to put it together, it's because God enabled you to do it. It's not because you were so smart and you were able to blend everything and fit it all together and make it see. That's not why you understand. Understanding comes from God. Then, as I have stated, the reason for these four global empires was to prepare the world for a different kind of concept of rule. See, Americans, who are largely responsible for the way the rest of the Christian world thinks, they don't have a good understanding of the kingdom of God. And so they don't understand how the kingdom of God works. So they have schools and seminaries and workshops and all kind of stuff to try and make things happen. But here you've got the premier man in the world at the time. He gets his word in the wilderness.
That's right.
How about that?
Yeah.
And just to show you, he was effective.
Yes.
He was effective. In the wilderness, by definition, it's a solitary place, a lonely place. It's an uninhabited. Mm-hmm. There aren't any cities in the wilderness. Uninhabited place. Desert. Absence of residence. Mm-hmm. And in preparation for his brief but essential ministry, like 6 months, he couldn't be in the city. He couldn't be in the city. Too many distractions, see? Not even in Jerusalem. He couldn't be. Not even Jesus was raised in Jerusalem. He had to be someplace where he wasn't distracted by other things. So he was in the wilderness. And the Lord himself would draw the people to hear John's. He didn't have to worry about promotion or how will I be made known or how will I get my name out there. He didn't have to worry about any of that. Now there is a. There's a kind of wilderness you can experience where less of the world and is found and distractions are reduced. There's that kind of, you've got to be able to pick up on it. There's that kind of wilderness. This is one of the many advantages of a godly assembly. It's like a worldly wilderness. That's why people don't go to the, maybe you haven't figured it out yet, why more people don't, quote, go to the church. Uh-huh. It's because they don't think anything's there.
That's right, yeah.
That's why.
Uh-huh.
That's why. If they don't think anything that can really advantage them is there, or they'd go.
That's right, yeah.
It's kind of a wilderness. But for us, this is the protection.
Yes, amen.
We, quite frankly, don't want this kind of people flooding in.
Yeah.
This is a who hath warned you to flee situation. Don't want this. Now, this is not a popular way to think, but if you're honest, you'll know that this is the kind of place you want. You want a place where there are not a lot of distractions. Of course, if the assembly is allowed to be pervaded with opportunists and a juvenile presentation and various forms of entertainment and unbelievers, the whole purpose for the assembly is neutralized.
That's right. Amen. Yep.
Because God doesn't dwell in a place like that.
Amen.
Yes.
I know for myself, I'm in the world much more than I'm in the assembly. And it does pay off to have like a safe haven from that environment.
That's right.
Also, we have this picture where it says a city set on a hill, a light on a hill, you know, it can't be. Can't sit on a hill, can't be hid. The light shines. Well, why does it shine? It's because it's a pure environment.
That's right.
Why, yeah.
That's right.
Amen.
If it were that kind of people flooding it, it wouldn't have that kind of a quality to it.
See, you know? The mentality, I was raised under this kind of a influence in the church world. The modern Christian person doesn't think something like that will work. Because the average Christian thinks that what God is trying to do is convert everybody.
Yeah, that's right.
That's the mentality, you know.
Amen.
Even though God has never represented himself as that's what he's trying to do.
Uh-huh, yeah.
If it was, he wouldn't be trying.
That's right.
He'd just do it.
Amen.
God, what God is doing, he's working. But he has a body of people in whom and with whom he works to fulfill his purpose. And when that is watered down with Pharisees, Sadducees, and so forth, then God doesn't work in that kind of environment.
Well, we've already seen, we know how God works. He can take a man and put him in the wilderness and bring the people
right.
that he wants to him.
That's right. See, the main thing about a church is just like it was with the synagogue and what it was with the temple. The main thing is to build up the people that are there.
Yeah. Amen.
Yes, Brother Justin.
If you were asked what would generate more warmth, the fire that is slowly built upon with larger logs and large amounts of fuel to where you have this roaring fire, or if you said, what we're going to do is we're going to hand out matches.
Yeah, everybody
in the community.
Like that. Yeah.
So, but it's that building upon it that makes that warmth much more warm, you know, than just light matches all over the community.
Amen. You can see, I'm sure if you can't, then really work on seeing it. That when the edification quotient, the EEQ, when the edification quotient is reduced, there's less divine activity.
Yeah.
Right. This is how it works. So if there's no edifying or building up of the people of God, I mean, God doesn't send a lot of angels to attend that assembly and everybody from heaven show up. This is not what he does. The word of God came to John in the wilderness. See that? You should see it. That's how it was. Now, the word was not in the desert. John didn't go out to the desert because the word was there. The word came to John.
That's right.
in the desert. So there's not an environment without personalities that if you can just get there, that's where everything is. Now there John is. Word of God came to him in the wilderness. And he commences to preach. He came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Now, nobody had heard anything. Nobody had ever heard anything like this before. Not many prophets called people to repentance. He rebuked them, but see, you just don't read much about it. This area that he was in was roughly about 100 miles north to south. Pretty significant region to be there, I mean, without an automobile. And it's a desert. It's a wilderness. So he's preaching the baptism. That was a new thing, too. Who'd ever heard? Nobody had ever heard of baptism. You say, well, I thought that Jews baptized converts from Judaism. See, that was a custom that didn't start until shortly before Jesus appeared. No, this wasn't the case. Jews never did baptize. They had diverse washings. No baptism like this. Matthew says that he was preaching in, quote, the wilderness of Judea, which was a pretty wide area. Mark says he baptized in the wilderness. See, this was his pastorate. This is where he was did his preaching, where he did his baptizing in the wilderness. You wanted to take advantage of John, you had to go out there. Jesus was baptized when he was in Bethabara. That's in kind of the southern part of the area. And then later he was found baptized in Ainon near unto Salem. That's in a little bit of the northern area. And he came into the country preaching, proclaiming. One version says calling. Lexically or by word definition, preaching means to be a herald. You're telling something that is.
Yeah, amen.
Versus telling people what they ought to be or how they should live. He was announcing something that was in place, or more specifically, that was going to be put into place. He was announcing something what God was going to do. He didn't go out preaching what people should do. When they came to him, he told them what they should do, but that's not what he was came preaching doing. See, preaching is fundamentally an announcement or a proclamation of something that exists already. In Scripture, our first exposure to the word preaching is found in the book of Jonah, but it's there. The preaching is a noun, it's not a verb. God told Jonah, he said, go and preach unto it the preaching. It was just it was a message. Preaching there was what was declared. Wasn't the declaring itself, it's what was declared. The preaching. So when it says John came preaching, he was telling something, a message that couldn't be changed. It was like cast in stone. He was preaching something you couldn't adjust it or manipulate it or change it or adapt it. You know, this is just was a solid message. Now, if you've been around for a while, you haven't heard much preaching like this.
Yeah.
Right? Where there's something is being said that is firm and stable, something you can build on, something you can embrace. It's unchangeable. Doesn't have to be updated. That's what preaching is declaring in Scripture. That's what preaching is all about. It's like a reporter putting in a newspaper what's happened.
Amen.
He doesn't give a dialogue about what he thinks. Some people, they have a column, you know, they give the thoughts of somebody about it. But before you know anybody's thoughts about something, you have to know the something.
Yeah, that's right.
Like he came preaching. Our time is a glaring absence of a message. Few people have a message.
Yeah.
It's mostly we ought to and we can and so forth. But it's not a message.
It's a word that you're not likely even preaching. Is a word you're not likely to even hear exactly in the church.
Right. It's kind of become obsolete. That's right.
It's too dictatorial.
Yeah.
It's too, you know, the audiences do not want to be preached to.
That's it.
They want
That's
to right. be advised and something along that line.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Now, he's preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Now, I want to take a little time and read what the other how the other versions translate this. It's rather interesting. The baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. All right, that's baptism of repentance unto the remission of sins. Baptism is a sign of forgiveness of sin for those whose hearts were changed. You see, there's two different views already. One is that the baptism was in order to obtain forgiveness, and the other version says the baptism was because they were forgiven. So you already got two different. Baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive them. Proclaiming an immersion involving turning to God from sin in order to be forgiven. Be baptized to show that they had repented of their sin and turned to God to be forgiven. Baptism of reformation to remission of sins. Baptized to show that they had turned to God and away from their sins in order to be forgiven, and so forth. There's an element of truth to these things, but I just like the way it says, baptism, the baptism of repentance unto or in order to the remission of sins. So you've got the remissions over here. To get to the remission, you gotta change. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Repent. You gotta change.
That's right, yeah.
Then you're baptized. Uh-huh. Then you get the remission. I mean, it's rather simple.
Uh-huh.
Matthew, he talks in his gospel. Here's how he comments on this text. And were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins.
Yeah.
So when they were baptized, they confessed their sins.
Yeah. Yeah.
Have you ever witnessed anything like this?
Mm-hmm.
It's just something to think about.
Yeah. Yes.
Mark's gospel says, John did baptize in the wilderness and preached the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And they went out to him all the land of Judea and of Jerusalem and were all baptized of him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins.
Uh-huh.
Paul, he said of John's baptism, some years after Jesus had been enthroned, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. So that's his comment on it. Came preaching. Now, I may have some trouble making this point. I hope not. You can either set out to try and change people, or you can set out to tell people what God expects them to do.
Mm-hmm.
Repentance is preached.
That's right. Yes, amen.
You've got to change.
Yes, amen.
We don't go. We're not coming to people with a solution to how they can change. Or at some kind of easy methodology over a period of time, you'll work this thing out. That's not even what we're saying.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just speak for myself. I'm against that kind of message. I'm an opponent. I'm an enemy of that kind of message.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever I've got opportunity, I'll cast it down.
Mm-hmm.
John called upon people to repent.
Yeah.
If you sin, you're under the dominion of sin. What do you do? Repent. That's what you're told to do.
Amen.
You're not told, get that thing straightened out. You're told, repent.
Amen.
See? Those days, John the Baptist, priest in the wilderness of Judea, said, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven's at hand. There's something's coming here, and if you're not ready, it'll just go right past you.
Illustration, like if you're going in the wrong direction, someone might shout and be like, hold it right there, because you just kind of freeze.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, repentance isn't just like like what you're pointing out here, it's not like a drawn out thing. It's like it calls for an instant change.
That's
like
exactly
stop
right.
Stop right
that's
now.
Exactly
like
right.
That, hold it right there. Like halt or something. Come back. Go the other way.
And when Jesus followed up, he did the same thing. He said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." After John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, "The time's fulfilled and the kingdom of God's at hand. Repent, ye, and believe the gospel." See, this is what sinners have to be told to do. There's just too much dawdling around with people that are living in sin, trying to help them get out of sin. This is all time wasted. This isn't how God works. You may think you've successfully addressed the situation, but you have not. This message has got to be preached. People have to be told, commanded, repent. And Jesus said, except you repent, you're going to perish. That's how. See? And this is simply not a popular message. This, you'll be called a legalist.
This mixed up. This, you said repentance, baptism, and remission.
Yeah.
But they've got baptism at the end.
I know.
It's like baptism doesn't really have anything to do with the removal of sin. They'll actually tell you that.
Oh, I know.
They don't have that. It's just a sign that you're in agreement.
Some of the versions, that's how they translate it. Yeah.
Well, that doesn't make any sense, does it?
Repentance. When Jesus sent out the 12 to preach first time, he said they went out and preached that men should repent. Yes. See this? It's a powerful, potent message. Men should repent. What should we do? Repent. Well, I've got this thing I've been struggling with for... Repent.
Yeah.
I'm not... My life's out of control. Repent.
Amen.
That's the word, see?
That's right.
It's not a popular word. I acknowledge that. Not a popular word. Jesus said, "I came to call sinners to repentance." See? After he rose from the dead, Jesus told his disciples, repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name. The apostles called upon men to repent and be baptized. Repent, and therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out.
Gets all the glory.
That's right.
Because you're acknowledging that you've done something that you can't change, but the very fact that you repent makes you in agreement with God.
That's right. Once you get in agreement with God, everybody sees this, do you? Once you get in agreement with God, God commences to work.
Amen.
Yes, Judah.
Amen.
When you repent, that means you're facing God then. When,
turn around.
When you're toward sin, your back is to God.
Yeah.
But when you repent, you're facing Him, and that's when God can work.
Mm.
Something else, I'm not sure if this is right, so correct me if I'm wrong. Repentance isn't you don't repent just to repent and then turn around and keep doing what you were. It's repentance unto baptism. Repentance... I'm getting myself all mixed up right now. I'm sorry. But my point is that you don't repent and then void the repentance and do what you repented from.
You can't repent that way. That's what it's called. Judas has said he repented himself. Then he went out and hung himself. So you can't repent and continue doing. This is like impossible.
Yes. Encouraged in the time in which we live, because Jesus has been exalted to give
repentance.
Yeah,
that's right. That's right.
Brother?
Yes, Brother Justin.
A person isn't going to repent unless they hear that they have to repent. You have to hear that you need to repent in order for God to be able to give you the repentance.
This is not a popular message. Yeah. In fact, I can't off the cuff think of the last time I heard this actually demanded.
Yeah.
What would happen if all the recovery programs, when the next time they met, they would just abandon the recovery book and told everybody to repent?
Yeah, amen.
What would happen? Well, the system would crash.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Amen.
That's why they don't tell people that. Got too much invested in this system. We can't afford for this system to fail. We sunk too much money in this.
I always found it really funny with the recovery programs they preach at the programs that you shouldn't talk about God, and that's not what the program is about. But yet at the end of the program, they say a prayer that says God in it. It's very confusing.
Well, that way, the person who does it gets the glory, see?
Yeah.
Now God, Paul preached to heathen people. He said that times of ignorance God winked at. That is to say, God didn't deal with sin directly because it would have destroyed everybody. So he waited for when Christ would come. Times of ignorance God winked at, but now he's not winking anymore. He's not winking anymore. And what people thought was a sign of divine love was really a sign of divine forbearance.
Yes, that's right.
He said, now he commands all men everywhere repent. That word's got to go out. The church is a custodian of this. This message has been given to the church. All men should repent. Yes. And if sin is dominant, men should repent.
Yes.
And if lives are out of control, men should repent.
Amen.
If they can't get a hold of them, men should repent. That's the message.
Amen.
So how's that going to work? Because if you preach God's message, God's power
is
with God's message.
Amen.
That's how it works.
That's right. So we're not against people recovering.
It's just the way that the recovery programs are set up, they don't recover.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Yeah.
Right.
See, this is the way people recover.
Yeah. Recover themselves from the snare of the devil.
Right.
But what they're talking about isn't really recovery. It's just getting back to your old natural self. God's not interested in you getting what you were before. What you were before you fell, that's not what you want to restore. You want to restore that? You fell from it once. You don't want to be what you were when you fell. To repent, so God will give you a power that He'll keep you from falling.
Amen.
Ultimately, all things are to the Lord. And if you fall short of that, then whatever you're doing, it comes short and is vanity. Repentance has to do with us coming to the Lord.
That's right.
In humility. Now, just to change our ways without coming to the Lord is a vain exercise. Even if you taste some measure of what you would call success, it hasn't ultimately been for your good.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Well, the only way it's for your good is if you realize you've sinned against God.
Yes.
That's right. And you do something about it.
Yes.
There's a lot of these places they're denouncing the thing that they are enslaved to, but until they complete that and turn to God, see, it's all for nothing.
The repentance, someone has already mentioned this. Go ahead, Brother Thurston.
It's about bettering yourself. It's about being right with God.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
I want to be right with God.
Yeah.
See, repentance is not a drawn-out process.
Yes. Amen.
Yeah. Brother Gavin. The way Sister June said it just cleared it up. It's not repentance, it's just a vain exercise. So if you have repentance, then you will have the other things because you're truly being worked with by God.
That's right.
Repent.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Repentance is not a drawn out process. It's a resolute decision.
Yes. Amen.
Accompanied by the cessation of sinful expression.
Yes.
See, the cessation of sinful expression confirms that you've repented.
Yes.
If you can't stop, you haven't repented.
Amen. That's it. Amen.
Yes.
That's why we should toss out sayings like continual repentance,
mm-hmm.
which I would liken to a top. which is constantly going both directions,
yeah,
back and forth, but that's not how it is. It's no. ceasing it altogether and leaving it.
That's right.
Amen.
Not going back.
Uh-huh.
Then if you get up to the highest point, of course, repentance is something that is given by God. The implication is that if a man actually makes up his mind to repent, that he'll be enabled to repent. But if a person says they repented, but they didn't cease, then they either lied deliberately or they just don't know what they're talking about. In our time, repentance, as I said, is not common.
This is one of those words, like in your Divine Nomenclature series, that has been hijacked.
That's right.
The word repentance doesn't mean in our world today what it means in the scriptures.
That's right.
It means that I'm going to try a little bit harder.
That's right.
But that isn't what repentance is.
Yeah, it's not just being sorry you did it. Sorry you got caught, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
Jesus said repentance and remission of sin should be preached. You can preach repentance, you can preach remission of sin because the Lamb of God took away sin. See, that's why sin can be remitted, is because Jesus took sin away. And the remission of John was in anticipation of Christ taking sin away. If you take Christ out of the scenario, John's preaching was void of power. It all depended on Christ. So here's John, word of God comes from the wilderness. He commences preaching repentance unto the remission of sins. And in so doing, he fulfills a prophecy of Isaiah several hundred years before that. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain and hill shall be brought low, and the crooked places shall be made straight, and the rough places shall be made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Well, let's look at that. That's quite a text. It is written. That's like a stamp of approval, see? That's like a validating stamp. Valid. It is written. These words are mentioned 80 times in Scripture. It is written. They never refer to the writings of uninspired men. Nobody ever said it is written of what some of the philosophers said. Socrates, Plato, who lived a long time before Christ. And nobody ever quoted them. Great philosopher, nobody ever quoted them. Isaiah said, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. So if what people are saying butts head with what is written, they don't know what they're talking about. Just plug your ears. Don't listen to it anymore. People have to take this seriously now. There's a divine purpose declared and reflected in Scripture that can't be distorted. I know people have this argument to... what if the scriptures have been changed? Or what if some scribal errors are in there? What? Well, if they're true, if the sophists are people that, you know, like a spider walking on water, they just kind of gloss over stuff. If their questions are valid, how can what is written be the touchstone of truth? How can it possibly, how can Scripture possibly be the touchstone of truth if it's not accurate?
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
We got all these versions of Scripture. No, we got things called Scripture. Uh-huh. We've got things that are called the Bible, but they're not the Bible.
That's right.
Yeah. They're a compilation of human ideas. Uh-huh. Some of them do us a favor by having the bottom half of the page tells you what they said. But that whole volume, they call it the Bible. There's a divine purpose declared and reflected in Scripture that can't be distorted. There's like a thread. There's like a thread through Scripture that puts it all together, and it can't be distorted. It doesn't make any difference what a person does with a verse or hate text. He can't distort this hidden, it's called hidden wisdom. You can't destroy this hidden wisdom that's in Scripture. Now, as you become more and more familiar with Scripture, you'll sense this. Maybe you haven't thought about it just in this way, but you'll sense this, that there's things put together in Scripture. And when you see it, how it fits together, that's the hidden wisdom. See, that no translator or no one can touch that. Amen. That's not perceptible to someone that's not reconciled to God.
Just an observation on that scribal error talk that you'll hear in our time. I've just found, you'll probably have to just see it for yourself, I found a lot of that kind of talk has a lot of root in disagreement with what's said.
Oh, yeah.
When they don't like what's written, that's when they say, well, what's the original saying? And just an observation, who has consulted the original when John 3:16 was quoted? Yeah. Does it really say love? Do we really have to love our enemies? Yeah. When you agree with that, no one mentions that.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
It's just an observation. You'll find when people argue about that, it's when they find a disagreement with it. That's when they bring that up. Mm-hmm. When they agree with it, they don't even think the question.
So in that case, the ideas of men are the touchstone.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Or the traditions of men.
This
is how it was when Jesus came. The traditions of men were the touchstone. If you violated that, then that's what made you wrong. The hidden wisdom, 1 Corinthians 2:7. Jesus referred to things that were hidden since the foundation of the world. Now they're revealed, but they're hidden within the framework of Scripture. They're hidden in there. And it's only as you are reconciled to God, have the mind of Christ and the Holy Spirit, that you're able to see the direction Scripture is going. All tangential teaching leads away from Jesus. Every tributary, see, you know, it leads away from Jesus and away from the way to God. That's why John the Baptist is discerned by what the Scripture said. You knew John was who he said he was because the Scripture identified who John was.
Yeah, that's right.
See, so if the Scripture doesn't identify who you are, unless you're a Terran, it tells you about that.
Uh-huh.
If the Scripture didn't identify what a Christian is, then we don't know whether they're one or not.
That's right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We're not going to make final judgment because we're not authorized to do that. But if what a person is in Christ, if what they really are, is not described in the Bible favorably, then we don't know whether they're in or out. And they don't either. It's important to note this, that here was a man defined by Scripture. Of course, Jesus was too. Jesus was defined by Scripture. The real people of God are defined by Scripture too. Now let's look at this. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. You have to, for a person to confront God, they have to be ready. Now Moses, this was made known under the law, that you had to be ready. Here's what God told Moses. Get the people. God was going to appear in a veiled form. He was going to appear to Israel, but they had to be ready. They had to be ready for this. Here's what God said to Moses. Go unto the people, sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. Let them wash their clothes. Someone said, well, God doesn't care what kind of clothes you're in. Wash your clothes. The third day the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. Thou shalt set bounds unto the people round about, saying, take heed to yourselves that you go not up into the mount, or touch the border of it. Whosoever toucheth the mountain shall be put to death, surely. There shall not an hand touch it. It shall surely be stoned. He shall surely be stoned or shot through, whether it's a beast or a man. It shall not live. Don't touch it. See, you had to be ready, but even then you couldn't like just barge in. When the trumpet soundeth long, they shall come up to the mount. And Moses went down from the mountain of the people and sanctified the people. They washed their clothes. And he said unto them, said unto the people, be ready against the third day and come not at your wives. about that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How about that? Mm-hmm. That's in the Bible.
That's right.
Note now the preparations. Wash your clothes. In the washing of one, help to clean up your consciousness, see of what you're going to be doing. Uh-huh. Be ready on the third day. Mm-hmm. Don't schedule something that's going to take you 3 days to do. Be ready the third day. Put a fence around the mountain. There'll be a bunch of dead kids all over the place if this is today. Put a harness on them kids. Don't, even your beasts, whether pets or otherwise, whether it's a man or a beast, somebody touches that mountain, they're going to be killed.
That's right.
You got to be ready for something like that. Don't touch the mountain. His long-sounding trumpet. It's a trumpet blast. I imagine it kept getting louder and louder. Come to the mountain. Don't come near your wives. Preparation. Had to be ready. That's what John was making people ready. Make his paths straight. Get ready. I want to comment a little bit on making his paths straight. I little chartology there. Jesus leaves heaven. He's going to ultimately return to heaven. And between leaving heaven and returning to heaven, there's a path. Make that straight. No bypaths. No detours. Don't be bringing up political issues to Jesus. That's a bypath. Don't be talking about domestic issues. That's a bypath. Don't be talking about personal aspirations. Let us sit on one hand, right hand, and left hand. It's a bypath. No family interests. It's a bypath. Tell my brother to divide the inheritance. No national interest. Will you restore the kingdom to Israel? No, those are bypaths. Make the path straight. Just a straight path. Just cut out all those bypaths. I will tell you, it'll be amazing how much progress you can experience if you get the bypaths out of your life.
Amen.
You will make remarkable progress. It'll you'll be confounded in it. Get the bypaths out. Yeah, this isn't something you can make by laws to do this, but it is something that has to be done. I wanted to say a word too about distracting religious activities. There's religious activities that are bypaths. They're distracting. Christian activities, purported Christian activities. Now, these things may sound really important. Philanthropic work, community service, feeding the poor. Now, none of us is against, but they're all bypaths. There's nothing in Scripture that did this. If they helped the poor, it was the poor widows in the church. If they sent food to the poor, it was the poor saints. There's nowhere in Scripture is there a single example of philanthropy being executed by the church, unless it's to her own. You just have to search and see now. Don't think that's so because I said it. You'll see that that's the way it was. One of the touchstones of whether you're saved or damned is how you treated God's people, not how you treated your next door neighbor.
Yes, amen.
Just in case somebody wonders. That's what Jesus said. Inasmuch you did it under one of the least of these my brethren, and as much as you did it not under one of the least of these my brethren, see. So the church isn't here for community improvement.
Yes.
The church isn't here to save the nation. Just quit posting those signs of people call by my name. That assumes that this nation is God's people.
That's right.
I'm not sure that's a proper assumption. What is right, this should be addressed to the church. The church should be told to do that.
Yeah, amen.
Because it hasn't... obviously done it yet. Makes make the path straight for Jesus. Because see, when Jesus comes, he's not going to dart off here, dart over there, be pulled over here into this, pulled over here into that. So your thinking has got to be adjusted for that kind of Jesus. Jesus will not be turned aside from his purpose. He will not. So if you try and do it, you just wasted your effort. He'll just walk right past you. I'm serious. That's what he'll do. He'll walk right past. Every valley shall be filled. See, there's no provision for a plummet. There's no traps. When Jesus came here, he didn't walk through a path that had traps and pit holes and things to fall into. He didn't take that kind of path. Get the valley. Get the holes filled up. Get the valleys filled up so that you don't have any downers. If you want Jesus to come your way, we're talking about if you want Jesus to come your way, you got to fill up the valleys now. See, what about those valley experiences that you have? That's not something you choose. Fill them up. Make no provision for a plummet down into a lower level. Fill up the valleys. Bring the mountains down. That's things that impede your progress. Standing in the way. Get them down. Level them. Level those things that slow you down. Bring them down. Clear the path. We used to sing a song, Glory, Glory, Clear the Road. I'm tired of toting this heavy load. See, when you have a... When you're burden, you're carrying the burden of the Lord, you know, it's, you don't like having to climb a bunch of little mountains. Bring them down, raise up the valleys. Make the crooked places straight. Make the rough places smooth. You're trying to make it to glory with a lot of rocks of distraction in the path, huh? You always got to walk around some kind of boulder or something. On the wrong road.
Yeah.
You get on the highway that God's raised up a highway.
That's
called
right.
The Way of Holiness. He's raised up a highway. There aren't impeding valleys and mountains and rough places and stones there. You got to get on a road where these things don't exist. I know there's distractions, but they're from the side. As Pilgrim's Progress illustrated, Satan was on the side of the road. He wasn't on the road. He's on the side of the road, and he's chained up. He couldn't get on the road.
That's right.
So that's Satan. If you want rough places and impeding mountains and valleys, you got to get off the road.
Uh-huh.
Don't you? You have to get off the road. And you'll have to humble down to admit you've been off the road. I mean, you have to humble down, but humble down, he'll lift you up. Won't be honest. See, this is what John had to do to prepare the way for Christ. He had to get everything out of the way that would detract from beholding him as he really was. So when people heard Jesus speak, it was on a level where they said, "Whoa, we never heard anyone talk like this before." See, they were up with a straight path. John the Baptist made a straight path.
Yeah.
John the Baptist cleared the stuff out that needed to be taken out. So when Jesus came, people could profit from his presence.
Amen.
And he said, all flesh shall see it. All flesh shall see the salvation of God. All flesh. See, up to this time, the salvation of God was never seen by all flesh. Noah, he's the only one. Him and family was the only one that saw the salvation of God. And Lot, him and his daughters, they're the only ones that saw the salvation of God. And all flesh didn't see the salvation of God. But Isaiah's prophecy states that this is going to happen. And this is what's stated here. Isaiah 40, verse 5. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together.
Yeah.
Together. How do you know, Isaiah? The mouth of the Lord has spoken it. So following the ministry of John the Baptist, the entire region eventually saw Jesus.
Yes.
And before this ends, when Jesus comes in all his glory, All flesh are going to see it together. Every eye shall see it. The mouth of the Lord has sworn this. He's spoken this. So what does that mean? It means I want to see him now. I don't want that vision to condemn me. See, if the way's not been made straight, and the rough place is plain, and the mountains brought down, and the valleys raised up, when Jesus comes, it'll condemn you.
Yeah. Amen.
Can you see that?
Yeah.
So you get, that's how you get ready. John the Baptist had the preliminary work. People had to be anti-sin and pro-Christ.
Yeah. Amen.
That was his job. Yes. And he didn't work any miracle now. He didn't do this with signs and wonders.
Yeah.
He did no miracle, the script says. He did no miracle. He just did it with preaching.
Yeah. Amen.
Not preaching nice things, you know, preaching repentance.
Yeah.
That's right. What he did, but God was in it.
Amen.
One of the jeopardies of our time is that a message is being delivered to the people that actually numbs the conscience. It insulates them. Some people go to church, and when they come away, they've been numbed. They've been inoculated with something that makes them spiritually unconscious. Well, this happens. Some of us experience things like this. All right, now the scripture says some people begin to come to John. A multitude. Text says, the multitude came forth to be baptized by John. Now, they had to go where he was. He didn't go where they were. And he says to this multitude, he'd say, looks like we got a good day today. Got all these people coming out. He says, oh, generation of vipers. Now, fortunately, Matthew identifies who this multitude was. He says it was many of the Pharisees and Sadducees. That's who he said this to. So this was a multitude of religious dignitaries. That's who this multitude, this wasn't the common people that he said this to. Here they came. He said, well, you generation of snakes, you're a bunch of snakes, that's what you are. I know how to win friends and influence people. That probably wouldn't go over, but that's what he said. He said, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? That's a good question to ask somebody. Now, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? There's wrath coming, you know. There's wrath coming. We're offering a refuge for whoever wants to get away from it. Whoever doesn't want to be condemned by it, we're offering a way out. Place of safety. Who warned you? Flee from the wrath to come. See, John's word kind of gives an index of something that's involved in repentance. Repentance is fleeing.
Yeah, amen.
Whereas Hebrews 6:18 says of Jesus, we have fled.
Yeah.
We have fled to him.
That's right.
For refuge. To lay hold on the hope set before us. See, if wrath's come, we're running away from the wrath.
Amen.
Not out in the wilderness someplace. We're running to Jesus to get away from it. See, that's the only way you can get away from it. That's the only way you can get away from the wrath that's coming. Is to run to Jesus. So we fled to him for refuge. So don't hold out. Jesus will be your friend. Jesus will be your friend. Well, he'll be... If you keep his commandments, then he'll be a friend to you.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Or you'll be a friend, he'll call you friend. Mm-hmm. But we're fleeing to Jesus for refuge. That's got to be made plain to people. Look, there's wrath coming. God's already said what he's going to do.
Yes, amen.
With people that don't believe. He's already said what he's going to do with people that don't receive a love of the truth. He's already said what he's going to do with people that don't obey the gospel. He's already went on record. Now, God can't change. He is going to do this.
Amen.
Now, we're offering you a
yes.
We're offering you a safety route.
Amen.
I really like the use of that word flee. No one who hears the word flee thinks of a stroll. It's running. And also in the event of flame, when someone's fleeing from something, they never stop running until the threat is gone.
Amen. And he said to these people, he said, bring forth fruits meet for repentance, worthy of repentance. Come on now, prove you've repented. If you really want what I have, what kind of evidence are you going to give me that you've repented? Well, I said I repented. Sorry, that's not enough.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, Paul preached this at least 15 years after Jesus had been enthroned in glory. This is what Paul said. O King Agrippa, this wasn't too long before he was martyred. O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient under the heavenly vision, but showed first unto them at Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coast of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. So see, that's up to date. I never heard anybody preach that. Have you? I'm telling the truth. I never have heard anybody preach this other than brethren that I know. This just is not, I never heard Joel Osteen preach this. This just is not a common message, but this is what John the Baptist preached. This is what Jesus preached. This is what Paul preached.
Yes.
Means repentance, genuine repentance shows in a person's conduct.
Amen.
And don't be saying that you're Abraham's seed. Don't be saying that. God can make children out of rocks. That's what he can do. So don't be saying that. He told, the axe now is laid to the root of the trees, plural, trees. The axe is laid to the root of the trees.
Uh-huh.
So when Jesus comes, he's going to cut down.
Yes.
He's going to cut down some trees. Every tree that my heavenly Father has not planted, every plant my heavenly Father has not planted, shall be rooted up, Jesus said in one place. This is the axe of judgment. These scribes and Pharisees, they're going to lose their place, be cut down. Divine favor was going to pass by these people. Jesus came to save, but some people were going to be cut down. Left behind, that's right. Now here's what Jesus said to the people is when he was here. Therefore I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. That's cutting down the trees. Whereas Paul said, breaking off some of the branches. The Israelites provoked God to jealousy with gods that were no gods. Moses had told people, "What? If you do that, if you provoke God to jealousy, you give to someone else what belongs to God. You serve someone else other than God. God's going to take the privilege away from you and give it to someone you never dreamed would get it."
Amen.
That's how God is. Paul goes on to say that God did not cast away his people Israel, the ones he foreknew. There was the remnant according to the election of grace. So he didn't eliminate the nation. That's why he cut the axe laid to the root of the trees. Not the root, the trees. God will not allow unfruitful trees to remain.
It
may look like they're remaining, but eventually. So John now announces an epoch in which a new king, a new covenant, and a new people are going to commence. All going to be new. Well, the people are stimulated by this. He said, bring forth works meet for repentance. So now they're going to ask, what should we do? How do we do this? So the people ask him, saying, what should we do? How are we going to bring forth? How can we show this? All right, here's what he said. You got two coats? impart to him that has none. Mm-hmm. And if you got extra meat, let him do the same thing with your meat.
Yeah,
what kind of advice is that? See, it's selflessness. Redemption involves the absence of self-centeredness.
Yeah.
So you got more than enough? Mm-hmm. Do you really have more than enough? Dispense it to someone that doesn't have enough.
Yeah,
that's how the kingdom of God works.
Yeah.
It's not self-centered. So see, he gave him something practical.
Yeah.
Practical to do. See, if repentance involves stopping living for yourself. He's affirming that when men have more than enough, it's so they can provide for those that don't have. That's how we taught the church. He taught the church this. Ephesians 4:28, let him that stole steal no more, but let him labor working with his hands the thing that which is good that he may have to give them that hath need. So see, that's why. You don't work. May I say this? If you only work to support your family, we're not going to condemn you for doing that because you have to support your family. But you can do better than that.
Yeah. Amen.
You can work so you can have to provide for those that don't have.
Amen.
What he said to do.
Yes.
What he said to do. Yeah. Why? Because this cultures you in not being self-centered.
Yes.
This helps you. This assists you in not being selfish.
Yes.
And God can pour it on. He can more than compensate. He can give you an exceeding abundance so you always have enough and always can liberally give to every good cause.
Yes, amen.
See, God's able to do that. John the Baptist began to teach people that. Then some publicans came up. The publicans were tax collectors. They collected revenue for Rome. These were not like popular people. They said, Master, teacher, what should we do? Well, he says, exact no more than that which is appointed to you. If the tax is 10%, don't take 12% and pocket the 2. Don't be thinking about yourself. Do what you're supposed to do and no more. Do what you're supposed to do, no more. Collect no more than is appointed you. Once again, John called men to not be self-centered. Now, the soldiers, this shows you the influence of John the Baptist. See the diversity of the crowd here? Here's some soldiers come up and say, what should we do? They're asking about these works, do works meet for repentance? They're asking, what kind of works should we soldiers do? What should we do? He says, well, do violence to no man. Don't hurt anybody. Now, he's not talking about in times of war. That's not what he's talking about. Don't throw your weight around. Don't be harming people.
Mm-hmm.
And don't accuse somebody falsely.
Mm-hmm.
Don't try and pin something on somebody just because they're convenient there.
Mm-hmm.
See, don't do this for self. And by then, be content with your wages, and they weren't the highest paid people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Be content with your wages. Don't be trying to maybe make someone give you some more money.
Yeah.
Threaten them if they don't. Don't do that. See how practical this is?
Yes,
but you see how swift John's able to answer?
Yeah.
He was able to take the truth and instantly apply it.
That's right. Yeah.
Instantly tell people what to do. Now, there are people that can do this.
Uh-huh.
This is still possible to do this.
Yes.
So what should I do? Just tell them.
Yeah.
You can't now just ask God to help you. You can come to a point now where you can tell people practical things they can do to get off the ground.
Amen.
Now it says that the people were in expectation, filled with expectation, or waiting, anxious. They knew something's about to happen. They were filled with anticipation. What happened? John had disrupted normalcy.
That's right.
Things weren't normal anymore. And I know John came and he said, whoa, something big's about to happen. It's not going on now. They were in expectation. Now, the church can have this ministry if it'll just wake up.
Yeah.
The church can have this ministry, can interrupt normalcy.
Yeah, that's right.
Averageness. Yeah. Just interrupt it. Something better. Not something better. Said all men mused in their hearts whether this was the Christ. Well, they said, boy, maybe we've lived to see Christ come. It's been, no one heard about Christ for hundreds of years. He hadn't been a prophet for about 400 or 500 years. And before that was 700 years. People were talking about a coming Savior. They hadn't been hearing. He said, maybe this is the one.
Their minds did go in that direction.
That's right. That's right. That tells you what kind of man John was and what kind of message he had. It just there wasn't any place for that type of thing in their society. Their church didn't have room for this kind of person at all. They mused in their hearts. I think that it's a noble ambition for you as an individual, for us as a fellowship, to seek to impress people that they know there's something else we can have. There's something we don't have that we can have. Something better and something good that we can have. Be one that can hold that out to out to people. But John, he knew he knew what they were thinking. He picked up on it. He's a discerning man. He said, well, and there's one that's coming after me. I'm baptizing you with water. The one coming after me, he's so great I couldn't even be a slave and untie his shoes. When he comes, I'm baptizing you with water. When he comes, he's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Who did he say this to? He didn't say it to the apostles because they hadn't even been chosen yet. They hadn't been chosen yet. I'm sorry, this disrupts some theology, but it does need to be disrupted. He said this to the multitude. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. That's what he said. Nothing like this had ever been said before. Joel said, I'll pour forth my spirit on all flesh. Some of the other prophets said he'd pour forth his spirit. But see, nothing like that. Nothing like this had really been said before. The most of the apostles that were there at the most was Andrew, Peter, Philip, and Nathaniel. They're the most. But this wasn't restricted to them. He said this, it says, to the people.
Yeah, right.
To the people. Amen. And he told, so that he's awakening expectation.
Yeah.
Can you see what he's doing here?
Yeah.
He says a message that will awaken expectation and hope. Maybe this is... Maybe I can get this.
Yeah.
See, that's what he says. That's the kind of message he's preaching. He said, now he's going to thoroughly purge his floor. This floor, which is in one sense is like the world, is like a floor. Or it's like a field. Or it's like a threshing floor. It's like a threshing floor that has wheat and chaff. It's like a field has wheat and tares. It's like a net that has bad fish and good fish, see?
That's right.
So maybe you've learned to live with this combination. But when he comes, he's going to thoroughly purge his soul. He's going to get rid, going to get rid of all the tares.
Yes, amen.
Going to get rid of all the chaff. Going to get rid of all the bad fish. And then what's, quote, left behind is going to be the real wheat.
Yeah.
And the non-tare, the wheat, the real tare, real wheat, he's going to do this. Now, knowing this, doesn't it make sense to repent? Knowing that this is what he's going to do now. He's going to thoroughly purge his floor. Right now we got a mixture. It's an aggravating mixture, but we got it. Even got it in ourselves, we got a mixture. We got a part of us we're anxious to get rid of and a part we want to keep.
Amen.
Well, he's going to thoroughly purge us for that. It includes the individual. Going to get rid of the old. Anything old. Anymore. Going to get rid of all the chaff. All the tares. All the bad fish that are rather all together now. See, they're mixed up together now. But they're all going to get rid of it all. In view of that, this is the time to repent.
Amen.
And get ready for that. And our text says that with many other things in his exhortation preached he unto the people. How about he preached an exhortation? It's interesting now. See, proper preaching should be accompanied with exhortations to move the people to act upon what they heard. Now this, we're learning to do this here, but see, you should know by experience, this is not something that's naturally in you. To take the truth and then urge the people to act upon the truth they've heard. See, that's what exhortation, that's what exhortation does. And in his exhortation, that's what he did. It wasn't enough just to make an announcement. He urged the people to act upon this announcement.
Yes.
The initial act was repent. That was the initial. I thank God for this. I thank God for people that urged me to do something. See, something more was being done with John than holding a seminar or a work session or, you know. It wasn't that. Now then, he throws this next sentence in. Doesn't look like it has any immediate. It said, but Herod the Tetrarch, being reproved by him for Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, and for all the evils which he had done, added yet this above all, that he shut up John in prison. So, what's that got to do with what we're talking about? Well, it's telling you that John dealt with sin wherever he saw it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Even in a king. Herod was reproved by this man from the wilderness. Now, I gather that Herod must have gone out to hear him. In fact, it says, other texts say that he heard him and heard him gladly, several times evidently. So he must have went out to hear him. One of these times, John had access to him. Herod had married his brother's wife. And John said, this is not lawful. It's not lawful for you to do this. Now, Herod appeared to be able to take it. Even though it does say he did seek to kill him, but apparently it was because of his wife, Herodias. This really aggravated her. Now, here's what was happening. John's ministry is coming to a close. And this is going to be, this is going to be how it closes.
That's right.
Huh? Paul's closed like this, too.
Yeah.
He didn't just go home in a cloud of glory, you know. He died and he was martyred.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Peter, same way.
Yeah.
This is how his ministry ended.
Mm-hmm.
When his ministry ended, there was no further reason to. Mm-hmm. It's like this, when your work is ended, it's like open season is declared. Whoever gets to you first. This is how his ministry ended.
Yeah.
But it's written up that Herod did a lot of evil things. He did a lot of evil things. John rebuked him for this wife thing, and then he rebuked him for other evil things he did. So he,
That's right.
I don't know what all it was, but he brought the hammer down on him. And so Herod, he did a lot of bad things. Notice what it says.
Yeah.
But this is added.
He
did a lot of evil things, immoral things, ungodly things, unlawful things. Then he married his brother's wife. And on top of all that, On top of all that, he imprisoned John. That's written in the books. Herod imprisoned John. There may be people that have done you harm. I got a line of them that just happened to me. I don't talk about it or think about it much, but a lot of people that have extended themselves to try and end my ministry. Yeah. They haven't been able to do it.
Yeah.
It's all in the books.
Yes, amen.
I don't have to avenge myself. Yes. You don't have to avenge yourself. This is going to be straightened out.
Amen.
He told you, he said, straighten out the crooked places.
Uh-huh.
And God's going to straighten them out too. And wherever somebody, anybody, anywhere, at any time, opposed and abused his people, they are going to pay for doing that.
Amen.
Maybe many stripes, maybe a few stripes, but they're not going to get by with it. And I can just, you don't have to, this is not to make you gloat.
That's right.
Yeah. This is to make you, put you at ease, that you don't have to try and settle this thing yourself. Just let it go. God's gonna solve it. You could even pray for your enemies, them to despitefully use you, because they could do with some prayer. Yes, Brother Justin.
In the trial, when someone's in your face, or if someone's doing something malicious to you, and that thought that they're gonna have to stand before God will actually give you peace.
Oh yes.
Yeah,
we're not, in this world, we're not judges. But in the world to come, that's another,
it's
another story.
It even allows you to do good to those who spitefully use you.
That's right. I have to close there, but I trust you got something out of that. I have a profound appreciation for John the Baptist. I want more to have more, because he did such a marvelous work, and he worked in such a difficult environment. But when Jesus came, the people were ready.
Yes, amen.
Any of you have a word you'd like to say? Yes, Brother John. Speak up, everybody, too.
Mark, you made about Herod, like on top of this, he put John in prison. You think, like, do good to all men, especially those of the household of faith.
That's right.
There was a violence, like, he did an especially grave crime when he put John in prison.
That's right.
Yeah, amen. Yeah. I really appreciated this, that the Holy Spirit wrote this down, that he had a fit word for everyone that came to him. And this is, I greatly seek the desires. You know, he didn't have a harsh word for him. He had a word that would assist them to get the work started. I really appreciated that.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
Amen. Yeah, Brother Judah?
We have this record about what a great man John the Baptist was, and yet the least in the kingdom is greater than is greater than him. He gave the analogy of a giant in a valley and a midget on a mountain.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And If John could do this before, he was the forerunner. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If he can be this great, how much more in the time when a greater light now shines,
amen.
We have much more available to us.
Amen.
And that in and of itself is an exhortation.
Amen.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah, you get the picture. It's where we at.
Yeah.
It's where we are at.
Yes.
That gives us the advantage, not what we personally... are. If you are as faithful with what God has given you as John was with what God gave him, you won't stay a midget, I'll tell you that. All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we are grateful for John the Baptist and his ministry, for the practicality of it, how he was able to stand in the gap, deliver your word and wisdom to the people. We pray, Father, that we would be determined to be that kind of individual, a person through whom you can work.
Yes.
We ask that this be the case in Jesus' name. Amen.